it please the court, and I just want to let the court know that I plan to reserve, with along with amicus, 5 minutes for rebuttal.
Just understand that you have to keep track of the clock, okay?
Understood, Your Honor.
Okay.
Thank you. My name is Kevin Kelly, and I'm owner of land of a proposed mitigation bank in the city of Poway in the Lake Poway watershed. I asked the court to conduct a de novo review of the 2013 MS4 permit, as well as the underlying environmental regulations and statutes, so that the Third Amendment complaint in this case can be reinstated. I have stated viable claims in the first, ninth, and tenth causes of action, which can be labeled the main watershed claims, and that addresses the sediment waste pollution resulting from the...
Counsel, before we get into the details of your complaint, I got to tell you, I'm quite disturbed about something. I just want to note something. This is from ER 10, ER 1917 through 18. This talks about your letter. You sent a letter agreeing not to sue the city, in quotes, to keep the content of the letter confidential, and to keep it confidential, if the city purchased your land for what you valued at $2,850,000, hired you as a consultant for 4 years to ensure that they would keep the contents of the letter confidential and not sue the city before the expiration of the statute of limitations for bringing a lawsuit described in the letter. Why does that not constitute attempted extortion under California Penal Code Section 519 and 523A?
Your Honor, it's not extortion because it's not illegal to offer mitigation land in exchange for...
That's not what you did. You said, I'm going to expose you and your violation of law unless you pay me $2,850,000 and hire me for 4 years. Why is that not attempted extortion?
Your Honor, that was perhaps inflammatory language, but in essence, it wasn't extortion. But the fact is, it's just a business exchange of land.
Business exchange.
Of land that is...
If you don't pay me just shy of $3 million and hire me, I'm going to expose you. I'm going to hire you. I'm going to expose you. Tell what bad people you are.
I'm not exposing anything, Your Honor. I've spent the last five years in litigation, and had they purchased the land, it would have avoided the last 5 years of litigation.
Oh, okay. Well, let me ask you this. Is there any reason why you don't think this ought to be reported to the State Bar of California?
No, Your Honor.
No reason that we shouldn't?
No, I don't believe that it should be reported. I mean, it's not extortion, Your Honor. Under the statutes, it's
maybe
not.
Maybe attempted extortion.
Not even where errors carried out, it would not be extortion, Your Honor.
Okay, go ahead.
Going back to the first and ninth, 10 causes of action, the main watershed claims deal with the sediment waste pollution that has resulted from a series of storm events, both in 2017 and 2019, that ended up flowing downstream through Warren Creek and ultimately into Lake Poway. The district court characterized the 2013 MS4 permit as providing a safe harbor.
Can I ask a little follow-up question? You got up and said you wanted to save 5 minutes for rebuttal, but you only have 15 minutes for you, which you're sharing 7.5 minutes of that with Coastkeeper. So if you're going to save 5 minutes for rebuttal, you've already burned through most of your time. You don't have 15 minutes plus 7.5 minutes, right?
Understood, Your Honor.
So do you really want to save 5 minutes for rebuttal?
I may have to subtract some minutes from that.
Okay, but just be aware that if that gets down to 7.5 minutes and you give him seven, you won't have any time left.
Understood. Going back, the district court characterized provision A4 as a safe harbor. Our argument is that intrinsically within the permit, there is a safe harbor provision B3C, and the complaint alleges that Poway has not undergone the iterative process, has not submitted a water quality improvement plan that would deem it in compliance with provision A1A.
Isn't what really happened here is you filed close to a 1,000-page complaint. I got to say, I've practiced a long time, been on the bench a long time. I don't think I've ever seen a 1,000-page complaint before. It's unbelievable. And yet, with all that you've filed, the district court found that basically you just had a bunch of legal conclusions, didn't plead specific facts to back up your claims. Isn't the district court correct in what you did here?
No, Your Honor. I mean, it was 1,000 pages, but a lot of those, majority of those pages was actually data that I collected over the last several years. And all that data is relevant and had to be in the complaint attached to the letters that I submitted, to the 60-day letters I submitted to the city of Poway. Had that data not been in there.
So let's go to your culvert claims. Let's go to something concrete, right? What is the effluent standard or limitation, waste discharge prohibition, or water quality standard that the city violated? Give me the section of it.
It's called the basin plan, and that is incorporated in the 2000 MS-13 permit.
Can you give me the citation to the provision that you pleaded was violated?
It's in Attachment A of the 2013 MS-4
permit.
Attachment A to the 2013 MS-4 permit, and that includes the discharge prohibitions, which include sediment, waste pollution.
Attachment A to the city's NPDES statement?
Pardon me, Your Honor?
Attachment A to the city's NPDES?
Attachment A to the 2013 NPDES MS-4 permit, correct.
And where in your complaint is that pleaded? The specific feasible factual allegations, not conclusory, but feasible factual allegations showing a violation. What did the city do that violated this attachment A?
The discharge prohibition, the sediment waste from the culvert crossings that were not permitted with a Section 404 permit.
And where is that in your complaint? Can you cite that to me?
From the Third Amendment complaint? I can.
Yeah, I know it's 1,000 pages long, but maybe you can find it.
The complaint itself is 240. I can pull up the complaint and tell you what that would be. And if Your Honor, I could come back, let Amicus argue and come back and answer your question. Would that help?
You're having as much trouble finding it as I did.
Well, I can find it.
Your time is up if you're sharing your time equally with the other folks here. So.
Okay. Thank you, Your Honor.
Thank you.
Thank you, Your Honor. My name is Drevitt Hunt. I'm with California Coast Keeper, and I'm here on behalf of the amici. And I first want to thank this court for allowing us the opportunity to present today and share our perspectives. That was in your discretion, and I appreciate this opportunity.
You'll have to speak up louder in case you want me to hear it.
Okay. Apologies, Your Honor. So first, I just want to take a step back and talk about the permit itself and what is required within the permit and how the permit is organized in order to explain why what the district court did when it interpreted Section A4 to require Mr. Kelly to plead non-compliance with Sections B and E.
Can I help you in terms of time? Let's say I 100% agree with you. The district court got it wrong, but the district court has thrown this out for a lot of other reasons. Since the district court's opinion is not a binding precedent, even if you're right, what do we do about that?
Well, I think that it clarifying what the permit actually does and what the permit requirements actually impose upon dischargers would be very helpful in ensuring that cities and counties which are subject to this permit don't misinterpret and start making additional arguments to plaintiffs, to the state.
And with respect, I get your point.
Okay.
And I actually agree with you. But my problem is this. Given what the district court did here in finding that essentially this was just a bunch of legal conclusions, it also got wrong what you're talking about, but this is a district court opinion. It doesn't really change the law. And so I'm wondering, do we really want to dive into just this one issue?
Well, I think that you could clarify the one point and just make clear that compliance with Section A4 is required by permittees who are not in compliance with Sections A1 and A2 of the permit. If a permittee wants to claim that it does not need strictly comply with Sections A1 and A2, it must go through the process that's in Section BC3. And
so,
thank you.
But
and
I
so,
guess my point is, how can we help? It doesn't make a lot of sense to me that we would write a limited opinion to deal with this one little piece of a complaint that has been thrown out, basically.
Well, a couple of things. One, I think that Mr. Kelly's complaint, and I didn't dive deep to find the exact citation, but I can give it a shot, does describe the sediment pollution. And the sediment pollution, if accurate, if alleged properly and if proven, would potentially give rise to a claim under the sections that he has also alleged have been violated in a conclusory manner. And so I think that it is important for this court to clarify what is a state of statewide relevance and precedent in terms of how this permit works. It's never been addressed by a court until the district court in this opinion, and the district court's opinion has it wrong. So I think clarifying how the permit works is a very important step in this case. And I'm going to take the rest of the time so that Mr. Kelly can respond.
Well, so you're going to let him have the rest of your time.
Well, I'd like to come back
as rebuttal,
for two,
right?
I'd like to come back for 2 minutes, but I'd like to give him an opportunity.
Oh, that's fine.
As well.
That's great. You all can allocate that however you wish.
All right. Thank you.
Very well. Let's hear from the City of Poway.
May it please the court, Josh Levine for the City of Poway. I would just start off by saying that this case differs very significantly from a standard Clean Water Act claim in a lot of different ways. And I think that one of the things that I would like to emphasize is that in a typical Clean Water Act claim, you have a very specific effluent limitation standard that is identified, it's clear, and you then, as a respondent, have the opportunity to correct that if it can be corrected, or you could take it to litigation if you think that it's wrong. I would look at this notice of violation that was received, hundreds of pages of just laundry lists of saying that the city did everything wrong under the sun, and the one thing that isn't in there is a viable, specific limitation, effluent standard that could be pointed to and could be considered by a city in order to address the concern. Frankly, once they received the notice of violation, the only thing I think that the city could have done to avoid this litigation was to write a check. But beyond that, there's nothing there. And I think that down below, the district court did an admirable job, a very patient job, in wading through a convoluted, difficult to read, sometimes contradictory complaint, and came up with a determination as to what there was a determination as to what was being pled, and compared that to the permit and said, well, what we don't have here is a specific violation that's being pled. There's nothing here that is actionable, at least my reading of the
What do you say to your friend's suggestion that there was a correct pleading of sedimentation pollution?
That is just if that is in the complaint, it was buried so deep that I don't think anybody reasonably could find it. What was pled in the complaint was that there were private residents, not the city, but private residents who were alleged to have had illegal crossings built on their own private land, and that these washed out during some significant rainstorm in 2017.
That's the culvert claim.
The culvert claim, yeah. Yes. That was what was pled. And the permit doesn't put any obligations on Poway to police private crossings on other lands. A permit could be drafted that way, I suppose, but it doesn't say that this is one of the obligations and that if there is a washout of these private permits, you have to do anything specific. So frankly, without that, they don't have an actionable claim. And I would like to address, because I do appreciate the amicus being here, because in their credit, they actually have a much more focused point to make. However, I think that they are reading something into the district court's order that is not there, or that was not there. The district court did not find there to be a safe harbor. The district court did not say, I believe that there's a violation that has been pled, but I'm going to excuse that violation because they have the city has complied with this. What the district court did down below is looking at the covert claims, looking at these allegations that these other non-party residents had built an unpermitted crossing and it had gotten washed out, looked at the permit and said, well, what does the permit say you do in this situation? And the permit doesn't deal with that exact situation. The permit does have obligations to put in a water quality improvement plan, a jurisdictional runoff management program. The court noted that they did that. But it didn't go. The court didn't go beyond that, and to say that there was a safe harbor. The court said, "Well, as far as I can tell, these provisions are applicable, and they were followed." So, on these set of facts, on these set of pleadings, I don't see a specific effluent limitation here. And I understand that Amicus is worried that this might. The district court opinion might somehow be used in order to support a larger claim. I think that any reasonable read of the district court of opinion is basically confined to the rather unique set of facts of this particular claim, where you have hundreds of pages of pleadings and difficult to read violations, and everything under the sun is being conclusorily claimed to be violated. And they went through and said, on that particular facts, I don't see a proper violation. So I believe that the district court's opinion was well reasoned and should be affirmed. And unless this court has some questions for me, I will submit on that.
I have one other question. During the litigation, at any time did Mr. Kelly reiterate his previous demand and offer, if you pay him a certain amount of money and hire him as a consultant, that he would drop the litigation that had already been commenced?
Not to my understanding.
Okay, very well.
Thank you.
All right, so you have... How are you dividing up your remaining time here?
Okay. 2 minutes for Coke's keeper.
Okay, very well.
And Your Honor, to answer your question, it's under 435-436, paragraphs 435-436 of the...
435 and?
436.
436.
Of the Third Amendment complaint. Those are the paragraph numbers. I could give you another list of citations, too, and they're also included in the briefing that I provided to the court as well.
I'm not so interested in the citation of cases. I'm interested in the alleging of facts.
Understood. And those allegations, citations to the Third Amendment complaint are included in the briefing.
Can you do the same with as far as the spring water claims?
I did, Your Honor.
I mean...
Oh, did you want to know that, too?
You have to look through your complaint.
Well, 447, 448, 449, 450, all the way through 538, Your Honor.
Okay, I'll take a look at those.
And then in terms of the second cause of action with regard to the spring water claims, the non-storm water, which contains pollutants that were all the data that I submitted that exhibited the non-storm action level violations. I have stated a complaint under provisions E2A7, which requires the City of Poway to address these stormwater discharges containing pollutants through either stream rehabilitation projects or in an effort to reduce the flows or getting a separate MPDES permit. The other group of claims that I have regards the lack of permits of the City of Poway. Failed to get for the stream water crossing rebuilding in 2017, as well as the Lake Poway boat dock. I think the district court was wrong in her order saying that a citizen cannot bring a lawsuit for a lack of a permit. Under 1311, that is a violation if you don't have a 404 permit, if the permit doesn't authorize all the different aspects.
Mr. Kelly, you're down below 2 minutes. You're going to let your colleague come up, or you want
to? I'll wrap it up, Your Honor. And then, in just regards to the 12th cause of action, I have alleged a substantive due process argument by the fact that Poway's action of putting the fact that this is a variable stream when, it, in fact, it actually is an intermittent stream harms my property interests for the proposed mitigation bank, in the sense that I can sell credits for the streams that I own to developers or to municipalities, and a classification like that lessens the value of those or makes the streams invaluable. And that arguably is under the Batson case. And with that, I'll reserve.
Very well.
So thank you, Your Honor. I just want to address one point that counsel for the city made, and that is that whether the district court's opinion is innocuous or not, and, you know, is it really a problem moving
your
forward?
Voice drops down when you make your point.
Sorry.
You want to do that?
So anyway, what the district court has done is that it has created the safe harbor provision protections under the permit in section B3C, but imposed them on section A4. Section A4 is about an iterative process. It does not provide safe harbor protection. And the way that the district court's opinion reads, which is that a permittee achieves compliance with the permit's prohibitions and limitations when it implements sections B and E of the permit, that is not how the permit works. And that would lead other cities, in, like Poway, to potentially argue that so long as we are doing what B and E required, we are in compliance with Section A provisions. And that's not how the permit works, and I do believe that it needs to be corrected.
Very
Thank
well.
You.
Thank you very much to both counsel for your arguments. The case just argued is submitted.